We seek refuge in Allah from our bad deeds and from His guidance, and we bring peace and blessings upon our Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, upon his family, upon his companions, and upon all of us here present today. Dear brothers and sisters, we are here tonight very pleased and happy to have with us our sister Afaf Nasheer. She is from Lawyer Group Care, and inshallah tonight she will be our guest speaker. We are very happy. Inshallah she will explain our rights in the United States, and she will explain while we are traveling, if we face any troubles or problems, what we need to do, whether if we are traveling with our visa, if you're traveling with green card, or if you're citizens of the United States. Inshallah, she will explain our rights, and we will know what to do in these situations. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless her. Afaf, please proceed.
But But the point is that her younger daughter was niqab, and they were walking in the street with their other children, and the mother was taking them to the park. And a woman saw the young daughter in a niqab. She didn't know how young she was, but the point is that she accosted her. She told her to take that off. She was saying bad words to her, cursing at her. She followed the family for 2-3 blocks down, saying bad things to them. Why? And when the mother intervened and told her, look, you don't know what you're talking about, she only got more hostile and aggressive. These are the kinds of hate crimes that we hear about every day, and these are the kinds of clients that we represent free of charge, but unfortunately, that's not the only discrimination that we face. We're also seeing a lot of work discrimination, employment discrimination cases. What does that mean? That means a sister who wants to wear a hijab to work is sometimes told that she cannot be in front of others because she doesn't look American enough. My question to that is, how dare you say what American should look like? This is the land of the free, and we are allowed to represent our religiosity in any way that we choose. Why is it okay to be undressed, but it's not okay to be fully dressed? Other issues that we've seen, and again, this is a recent case that we have seen, is a brother was seen praying at his workplace. His supervisor saw him. He said, you can't pray here. He said, I'm a Muslim. I have to pray 5 times a day. He said, fine, you're allowed to pray in this one particular space. When he went to that one particular space, that was the room where there were mountains of garbage. These are the things that we're facing, and it's not just us. If you go to the federal agency, the EEOC, the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, you will see that their own statistics say that 30% of their cases regarding religious accommodation and discrimination at the workplace is being filed on behalf of Muslims. Well, only 2%, 3% of what? The entire country's population? Yet 30% of the cases that they have on file are from complaints stemming from the Muslim community. We also very tragically see things happening in schools. I have had situations in which someone in my own family, a girl from my family, was told by her teacher that he thinks her religion is stupid. This is his words to a young person's face because she refuses to wear shorts during gym class. So when you are being bullied in school, not just by other young kids, but even by the administration that is supposed to protect you, then it is our duty as the adults in the community to fight for our kids, because it's not enough to tell our young people that they are to be proud of their faith and their deen if we are not going to back them up with what is needed to allow them to hold their heads up high. And then, of course, I'm going to get into the main topic of today, and that is law enforcement issues, and in particular, surveillance upon the Muslim community. How many of you have heard of the Office of the Inspector General? All right, the OIG, the Office of the Inspector General, is this agency, it's a state agency, city agency actually, that has the right to audit the NYPD. So they take records from the NYPD and they examine them randomly. And recently, they did an audit of the intelligence department of the NYPD, and what they found is that 95% of the intelligence is done on the Muslim community. 95%. And I really sort of want you to understand what that means. You have to understand that there's a lot of federal money being put into intelligence, obviously. And the NYPD is a model not just for the United States, but even around the world. So when they focus and put into practices like this, other police departments follow suit. And imagine the resources, the millions of dollars that they're putting into surveilling the Muslim community. Just yesterday, I was at a college campus and we were going over what surveillance means in school. I don't know if you guys know this, but a few years ago, this huge story came out which basically told the world that the NYPD has been infiltrating college campuses' Muslim students' associations. It got so bad in some schools that I'll give you, I guess, the example from the paper. Was that in one particular school, they had a woman who decided she was going to take shahada. The story that she gave the MSA was that she comes from a Turkish family who's not very religious, and she wants to take back her faith and learn about Islam. What do you think that the sisters in the MSA did? They welcomed her with open arms, right? Isn't that what our dean teaches us to do? Little did they know that for over a year and a half, almost two, that the entire time she was an informant for the NYPD, taking notes on everyone, following everybody, getting to know people. They took her everywhere with them. To the point where one sister actually invited her to her wedding as a bridesmaid. And then you have to understand what that does to the psyche of our youth when, after you get that close to a person, you find out that the entire time they were abusing your trust. What does that do to your ability to trust anyone else again? The girls were saying, you know, I wonder, I brought her to my house. She was in my bedroom. Now I wonder whether or not, you know, I can even trust my own space, whether there's a camera in here or something. You start to question everything. And the NYPD was not just in New York City schools, not just in CUNY schools, not just in private schools, but they were all over Long Island, they went upstate, they went to Ivy League schools, they went as far to New Jersey and Pennsylvania, even though their jurisdiction is only in New York City. These are the surveillance issues that we are facing and seeing every single day at CARE New York, and these are the kinds of things that we fight on behalf of the Muslim community. But one of the ways that we fight, I always say there are two ways that we fight. One is proactive and one is reactive. Reactive means when the Muslim ban comes out, we get thousands of people into the airport, we take to the streets, and we go to court. Reactive means when somebody comes in with a hate crime case, we make sure that the hate crimes department takes the case seriously and they do what they're supposed to do as far as investigating, and that the prosecution prosecutes to the fullest extent of the law. And then if there's a civil suit to be done, we'll take care of that as well. Reactive means that when a student comes in and says they're having an issue at school, that we're there face to face with the principal and telling them, you know, there's an issue here that needs to be addressed. Those are some of the reactive measures. But proactive means coming into spaces like this, Islamic community centers, schools, we'll go anywhere, and letting people understand what their rights are as a citizen or even as a non-citizen. Because in one weekend, one Saturday and Sunday, right before the presidential election, CARE's offices, we have about 35 offices across the country, CARE's offices received about 100 calls from Muslim families saying that they received a knock on their door from the FBI who was asking them questions. 100 in one weekend. What does that mean for all of you? That means each and every one of you has the responsibility to learn how to react if somebody ever comes to question you or your family. Because you do have rights. But you can't utilize those rights if you don't know how to react. And let me tell you, at that given moment, it's sometimes intimidating. But the more you hear it, and the more you understand it, the better able you'll be able to assert yourself. So what are those rights? I'm going to be very simple and basic because at the end of the day, I want to keep it simple and basic. If I keep it simple and basic, it better protects you and you keep it in your mind. If someone comes to your door, whether it's NYPD, whether it's an ICE agent, whether it's FBI, any kind of federal enforcement or a state enforcement or city enforcement agency, and knocks on your door, you don't even open the door. You know how you usually ask who is it before you open the door? You know how we teach our kids don't open the door without asking who it is? That's what you do. That's, you know, the common sense. And if they identify themselves as law enforcement, which they should do, and they say, I'm looking for so-and-so, my name is so-and-so, can I please speak to you for a minute? You don't need to say to them, why are you here? Why do you want to speak to my son? What do you want to talk about? Come in. You don't need any of that. Your one simple reply is, Agent so-and-so, please leave your card in the mailbox or slip it under the door, and I'll be happy. not being hostile, you're not being aggressive, you're not being non-cooperative, but you're protecting yourself and your family. Why do I say don't open the door? Some people say, what's wrong with opening the door? What's wrong with speaking to them? I'm a good citizen. I know I'm not doing anything wrong. I want, you know, to do my civic duty, and I don't have anything to hide. To be honest, I think that is in part naive, but it's understandable naivety. Because in our faith, and in many countries that we come from, you don't speak to law enforcement the way I just told you to speak to them, right? In most cases, most Muslims from most countries, if law enforcement comes to your door, you're not gonna say, no, I'm not opening the door for you. That's unheard of for most of us. But in this country, it's different, and I need everyone to feel comfortable to assert their rights. And as I always point out, if a law enforcement person goes to the president's house, and the president with all his money, all his clout, all his political connections, what do you think he's gonna do? He's gonna slam the door in his face and say, talk to my lawyer. So if he's going to assert his rights with all of his power, why can't we do the same to protect ourselves and our families? I'll give you an example of why you shouldn't speak to anyone. And let me just sort of, you know, make it clear. If you know that you were just involved in a car accident, or you just saw a car accident and you were a witness to it, and that's what they want to talk to you about, then that's understandable, right? But I'm talking about this random knock on the door in which they want to talk to you, and you don't know what it's about, and you don't know if you're being investigated, or perhaps they are asking for information on someone else. The point is you don't need to find out, that's what we'll find out for you. But if it's something like I said, you know you just saw an accident or something, you know, that you know is in your head, and you understand why they're there, and it's limited in scope, then that's a different matter. But for example, if a law enforcement agent comes in and he asks you, are you a member of so-and-so masjid? And maybe it's even in another state. And you say, no, I'm not a member, right? I mean, you're thinking in your head, I'm not a member of that masjid. I don't even remember ever going to that masjid. Little do you know that 3 years ago, you were in a different state, you needed to pray book, so you stopped at that masjid and you prayed at it. Now, if he was asking me that question as your attorney, I would say, wait a minute, what do you mean by member? Does it mean that they have an official membership? Does membership mean that they donated to the masjid? Maybe you donated to a masjid and that counts in their mind as member. Maybe you've never even stepped into that masjid. But you understand that as attorneys, we are going to make sure that your rights are preserved and ask questions that might not even come to your mind to ask. We have had situations in which my brothers have actually invited officers into their home, served them tea and cake, and spoken to them for half an hour, thinking if I speak to them and I show them openly what a good person I am, they won't come back. In most cases, they come back. They come back, and if they're not investigating you, it's because they know you're willing to talk to them, and they want information on others in the community as well. When they knocked on those doors before election weekend, it wasn't because they were investigating the particular person in the house. They were just trying to gain information on most community members. I have had situations in which a young man who was born here and should know his rights spoke to an agent multiple times to the point where the agent had his cell phone and was texting him in different points of the day. And he knew he was getting in deeper and deeper, but didn't fully understand what he had gotten himself into until one day the agent took him into his car and he said, look, I help you, you help me. I scratch your back, you scratch mine. And then he knew that he had gotten in way too deep because he started asking about his family and other people at the masjid. And don't you know that when I spoke to that person and I told him, look, he's gonna contact you again. What are you going to tell the agent when he contacts you? And I told him to say exactly what I told all of you. I told him to say, next time he comes, you tell him, I'm happy to answer your questions through my attorney. I said, what are you going to say? You know what he told me? He said, well, I'm going to tell him, you know, I can't keep talking to him, and, you know, there's not, you know, I need to vindicate myself. I said, what are you talking about, vindicate? Vindicate means that you have to assert your innocence. Why are you even thinking in those terms? Listen to what I'm telling you to say. And so I'm going to repeat this line repeatedly throughout the evening so that you get it into your mind. And I've noticed that with clients, it helps to repeat, and sometimes I even make them repeat it to me, because even though it's a simple line, sometimes it's difficult to get those words out. And if it's difficult for people to get the words out when they're speaking to me, then imagine yourself when you're across an FBI agent. It's a lot more difficult. Even attorneys have felt intimidated in certain situations. And so you actually need to practice saying those words. You need to tell them, please give me your card, by give me if you're already in front of them. But otherwise, if you're behind the door, please leave your card in the mailbox or slip it under the door. I'll be happy to have my attorney call you. Politely, respectfully, but assertively. And the more they insist on speaking to you, the more you assert that line over and over again. You are not required to open the door. The only time you are required to open the door is if they have a search warrant. Has anybody here heard of a search warrant? If there is a search warrant, what should you look for in a search warrant? Can anybody name something that they think is important to look for in a search warrant? I'm sorry?
Case.
A case number? Maybe they don't have a case yet.
The judge's name?
Yeah. The judge's signature. You want to make sure it's signed by a judge, because ICE agents these days are going into people's homes and showing them official looking documents, but it's not signed by a judge. They just get you to open the door so they can charge it. The other thing you should look for with a search warrant is read it through, check the judge's signature, but understand that a search warrant doesn't mean that they get to check your house from the basement all the way up to the attic. Search warrants are usually very specific. They say you can search this particular area. And if you do, they do have a search warrant and they come into your home, you want to understand where they're supposed to be. So if they're allowed to come into your garage and you have a separate entrance from your garage, are you going to allow them to go into your home? No. Allow them the entrance to the garage. If they're allowed to go into your study or your particular area, basement or to whatever it is, then you escort them to that one particular area. If they happen to be walking down the hallway, they see your bedroom, they say, what's this? Do you mind if I take a look? What's your answer?
No.
I do not consent to any search. You want to be clear. I do not permit any search. If they end up taking things from your home, you want to actually grab a notepad and you want to take notes, right? You want to note, for example, how many officers were there. You want to take note of who was there, so get business cards, right? You want to ask for names. If they take anything out, let's say, for example, they grab your laptop or your computer, you want to make a note of that. And you want a copy, obviously, for the search warrant. And you want to contact an attorney immediately. These are some basics with a search warrant. The other kind of warrant is, of course, an arrest warrant. And inshallah, none of you ever see that, inshallah. Having said that, an arrest warrant allows them to arrest somebody. So if they have an arrest warrant, you don't allow them into your home, whoever they have an arrest warrant for should actually step out, because you don't want to open up your home where they can search you or take a look or see something that they think is suspicious. Because in certain cases, if they see something openly that is suspicious, they may have a right to take a closer look. And you don't want to open that opportunity. Okay, so we talked a little bit about search warrants. We talked a little about if an FBI agent comes into your home. But as the Imam talked about, there's also issues that we know about in the airports. Those are huge issues, because so many of our Muslim brothers and sisters have to go to second screening where they travel in and out, right? So there's primary screening, meaning you come in and you go through customs like everybody else and they ask you certain questions, right? They say, where did you go, for how long, questions that pertain to your travel. You usually answer them, thank you very much, sir, thank you very much, ma'am. You go through, halas, that's it. But what we're seeing is that many of our brothers and sisters are subjected to what's called secondary screening, where they pull you aside and they say you have to go to another office. What happens to the other office? Well, for one thing, you're going to see a lot of other Muhammads and Ahmeds and Aishas and, you know, unfortunately. And there you will sit in a room until you are called into a smaller room and you sit across one or two agents. Are they allowed to check through your bags? Yes or no?
No.
Okay, I heard no. Yes, they are. They can search through everything that you have, and that's normal for everyone. Right? So that's completely legal. They can search through your luggage, they can search through a handbag, they can search with anything that you come through. And that is within their right, that's always been their right. Can they take your telephone? Do you have to give them a password?
No.
So here's the deal with the law and the passwords. By the way, this is something that we are very aggressively fighting because we know that the majority of the issues that we're facing are onto our community, right? We're not talking about, right, you know, non-Muslims, Christians that are being subjected to these policies. Communities of color and Muslims, right? So you're taken into a room. They will and often do ask for your phone. What the law says is that they cannot force you to give them knowledge that you have in your head. What does that mean, really? It means that the law hasn't caught up with technology. That's what it means. And so for your cell phone, you lock it using your thumbprint, is that giving them knowledge? No, it's not. So if you're locking your phone by your thumbprint, guess what? That's not good security for you. But if you're locking your phone by password, by, you know, pattern, by numbers, you don't have to give them your password. So that's a small piece of information that's good to know. How about your laptop? Can they take your laptop? Yes. They can take your phone and tell you they can take anything that you come into or out of the country with. So if you're carrying important things that you need, and we've had issues of this even, let's say, with doctors or attorneys who have confidential information on their, you know, on their computer, it becomes very problematic. And by the way, when they take your phone, I mean, they've downloaded everything. They go through everything. They download everything to search. We put in God knows where and what database. And I just sort of want to really emphasize this because we all, I mean, you know, especially the younger people, you know how much of your life is on your phone. Everybody. And you know that you're in a WhatsApp group where you're getting 100 messages 100 people, of which 90 of them you've never even met before in your life, and it's coming through with this, you know, in this language, with this shape on it, and you don't even listen to half of them because your phone is full. You've probably got 562 messages in your email box that you haven't even checked yet, but now they're checking it for you. So I want you to sort of really understand what that means. All right, the truth is that when you're in an airport or any border, your rights are at its lowest. That's why they can search through these things without a search warrant, right? Because if you had your computer at home, can they take it from you? No, only if it was in the search warrant. If the search warrant says that they can take your computer, then that's something they can take. But in the airport or any border, if you're coming through Canada into New York, or anything like that, your rights are at their lowest. And there are different rights depending on your immigration status. If you're a United States citizen, your rights are the strongest. And again, this is only, I'm emphasizing this is only at the borders, only upon entry into the country, okay? So this is not in the street or somewhere else. On the street or somewhere else, generally speaking, all people have the same rights, even if you're not an immigrant, so generally speaking. But at borders, it's a different game. If you are a U.S. citizen in the country, let's say you've committed a crime or you're suspected of committing a crime, can they deport you? How many people say yes? By show of hands. If you're a citizen, they must grant you re-entry. They cannot deport you. If you're a United States citizen, they must let you in no matter what. How about if you're a visa holder?
They can reject you.
They can reject you. Because a visa is not a guarantee of your entry. Why do I bring this up? Because here I am telling you, on the one hand, don't give them your password. But if you're a visa person, you're here legally, but you're not a citizen, you're not guaranteed entry. And if they think that there's enough reason to deport you or to not allow you into the country, that's a possibility. So even though we generally tell people never consent to a search, you also have to take into mind these considerations and use your judgment. So what happens if you're a citizen and you refuse to give your password? What are they allowed to ask you and what are they not allowed to ask you? Generally speaking, there are two topics that they should be able to ask about that you should answer. One is who you are, your identity. They have to verify who you are, that you're saying that you are who you say you are. So your name, your birth date, your country of birth, that type of thing. That pertains to proving that you're who you say you are. And the second thing is your travel. Where were you, for how long, for what purpose, those types of questions. But the minute they start asking you questions like, do you pray 5 times a day? Have you gone to Hajj? What do you think of the political situation in Syria? Do you follow any particular sheikhs or imams? Do you go to the masjid often? These are questions that they ask people all the time. All the time. These are not things I'm making up, I promise you. And those questions are inappropriate. They should not be asking you about your religious practices or your political views. And when they get to those types of questions, your response should be, you know, I'll be happy to answer questions about my identity and my travel. But anything more than that, about my religiousness or about my political views, I'd appreciate you ask those questions to my attorney. And that's it. Again, respectfully declining to speak to them without an attorney present. Worst thing that can happen if you're a citizen is that you'll get delayed. They may hold you there for a little longer, and you're sitting there looking at your clock, and your family's waiting for you to get out. And by the way, when you're in there, you can't use your phone. So don't think you're going to have access to your phone and calling your attorney then. And I'll tell you what to do ahead of time. But I would rather you delayed for 2 or 3 hours in inconvenience than opening up the door to something much more. So what do you do before you travel to protect yourself? Well, one thing you can do is to make sure you share your itinerary with your family members and you let them know. When you're taxiing, when you're down on the ground again, that's one of the last times you have an opportunity to call your family before you go through customs. So you let them know, I'm down on the ground. And if you're not outside by an hour and a half, they should call us. Because we'll call customs and say, what's going on? Are they being helped? Where is this person? And we'll make inquiries on your behalf to let them know that we're aware that they're holding you. And that changes the game. Another thing you should do when you travel is to take a picture of your passport and leave it with your family member, because we will need that information when we call on your behalf. So keep that in a file with your itinerary, let them know when you arrive, and then if you're not out 2 hours and they suspect that you're being questioned, then we can start pushing things, and if need be, we'll send an attorney to the airport for you. Those are some basics when you're going through, you know, so you get a knock at the door and at the airport. Now what happens, I'm gonna take it somewhere else now. How about if you're in a car? Most of us have gotten stopped by an officer at one point or another for something. How do you handle a situation like that? Well, if you're stopped, obviously you're gonna pull over to the side, somebody's going to come. I'll relay my personal experience and you please use that as your example. I was one time on Main Street at a time in which it's super crazy crowded, and I had to make a turn. Little did I know that between 4 and 7, you couldn't make that particular turn. I'm just thinking, I need to make sure I don't hit somebody because everybody's crossing the street at all crazy times and nobody's paying attention to the lights. So I'm paying attention to the people that are in the street. I make the turn, lights go off, realize they want me, so I stop on the side. The very first thing I do, the very first thing that you're going to do when you stop the car, is you're gonna put your hands on the steering wheel where they can see them. You don't keep them on your sides, you put them on the steering wheel. Why? Because they want to make sure their safety is their number one concern. So they want to make sure that they can see where your hands are. So you put them nice and clearly flat on the steering wheel. That's exactly what I did. The officer comes to my window. Good afternoon, officer, how can I help you? Do you know what you did wrong? No, I honestly don't. You made a turn, you're not supposed to. I apologize, I honestly didn't see the sign. Can I see your registration and your license? Now what? Guess what, folks? It's in the back seat, in a black purse, in a black wallet. There was no way I was going to make a quick turn and grab my black wallet out for him to freak out. So what do? I say, officer, I'll be happy to get that for you, but I want to let you know that it's in the back seat, and my purse is a black purse, and my wallet is black, and it's inside the purse. Would you still like me to get it for you? In other words, I'm making it very clear what I'm going to get and where I'm getting it from. He said, yes. I turned around to get my purse, and wouldn't you know it, that I didn't even realize his partner I was already on the other side of the car with his hand on his side. I didn't even know he was there until I turned around. And so I turned around slowly and I kept the communication alive. He said, all right, I'm grabbing my black purse now. I rang it to the front. I said, I'm gonna grab my wallet now. I took it out slowly and then I gave it to him. He knew why I was saying that, right? But it made things clear for him and for me, for his protection and mine. At the end of the day, he didn't ticket me. But the point is that's how you handle it when you're stopped. What if he asks to check your car? Can you search your car? It's a mixed sort of answer. Generally speaking, no. And you always want to keep in your mind that you should never consent to a search. Even if they have the right to search it, but you're not sure, it's better for you to say, I don't consent to a search. Never give them the permission. Because once you give them the permission, anything they find, they can use it against you. But if you don't give them permission, and they take it illegally, meaning there's a problem with the search, then they can't use it. Understand? The rule is if they see something in plain sight, meaning if they see something right in front of them, if they see a bag of something and they think it's weed, then they can search your car because they see something that might be illegal. It's an open sight. But generally speaking, they cannot never want to consent to a search. If they insist and you feel like you're being threatened, then you have to judge the situation accordingly, right? But even if you feel compelled, if you're feeling forced to allow the search to go through, and you open your trunk or whatever it is, you still want to state respectfully but assertively, I do not consent to a search. That way when you go back, your lawyer can say, you told the officer on multiple occasions he doesn't consent to a search and he had no right to go in. Understand? So that's my husband. He's reminding me to leave time for questions. He always says, whenever you give a speech, keep it short. He uses that line when we argue too. Having said that, I think it is time for me to answer questions. And it can be about this or about something else. I'll be happy to answer them to the best of my abilities. And I also want to point out that I know various information came out. Yes. And there's a sign-in sheet too. Please do sign in, because what we'll do is we'll keep you updated on what's going on. There's a lot of things that are going on. I only touched a small, small fraction. Inshallah, this is about your rights with surveillance issues and law enforcement, but that doesn't mean that we can't come back and talk about what's going on in your libraries, what's going on in schools, and inshallah, bring in more people. The only other issue that I think is really important for me to touch on before I do questions, this is also about, you know, surveillance and coming in and out of the question, in and out of the country. I'm always reminded by this one client who comes in and out of Canada a lot because he has family in Canada. And he says, I used to come out and in, no problem. He says, I used to come back into the United States and they would tell me, welcome home. Now, they pull me aside. They question me, I have to come out of my car with my family, my wife is crying, I'm an older man. He says, I pay my taxes, I'm a physician, I vote, I do everything right, I volunteer time. And I still have to stand there and answer the questions, why? And it's a legitimate question. And the true answer is because you're Muslim and you're being religiously profiled, unconstitutional. You're discriminating, it's illegal, yes, but that's the true reason. And if we're not fighting aggressively against it, it's going to continue happening worse and worse and worse. And I try to end with this one point. It's not just the immediate consequences of what we're facing. It's not just the frustration that a person feels when you know you're being targeted because of your name or your faith. But it's also the fact that, let's say, for example, when you're with your family, you're standing outside of your car, right? And all these other cars are passing by you. And now your children are embarrassed by what's happening and what's happening to them. They're keeping their eyes on the ground, right? Because they know that other people are looking at them. And what are the other people thinking as they're passing through? They're thinking, I wonder what they do. Do you understand how one thing feeds into another? The reason that this has been legitimized and normalized by people who are not facing the discrimination is because of these types of things. Because we've been made to be suspicious just because of our faith. Because even though white supremacists commit acts against this country time and time again, they're never called terrorists, but when it's somebody who's even remotely connected to Islam, even if only by name or ancestry, we're all blamed and labeled as terrorists. That's the truth. And so I bring this up because now your child is looking at the floor, and as a young Muslim, he's being taught that his name or his faith is making him an enemy, and he can't hold his head up high. And all the other kids who are passing by are looking at your kid and your family and thinking, I wonder what they did wrong. And this is how the hatred and the suspicion continues through the next generation. And how do we expect a whole generation of young people to feel proud of their faith and their deen and live it out unapologetically if this is what they're experiencing from the time they're this long? This is part of the reason why I'm very passionate about what we do at CARE. I myself have children, and I cannot look them in the face and tell them to be strong Muslims if I'm not fighting this for them. will do everything that we can for the Muslim community. We're the only Islamic organization in New York that actually represents these types of issues, day-to-day issues for the Muslim community. Please check out our website. It's on the cards, on the information that you have. And don't ever hesitate to reach out to us, whether it's something proactive, like an educational workshop. There's a multitude of different ones we can do. Or if you're ever in a situation in which it's reactive and we have to help you in the situation. Anything discriminatory-based, whether it's something about surveillance in law enforcement or something else. Inshallah, never, but know that the service is there. Let's take questions. Questions, please?
Yeah, are you allowed to record during the whatever search or arrest or whatever?
Mm-hmm. So, excellent question. His question was, are you allowed to record the agent or the officer if they're searching or questioning? Different states have different laws. In New York, yes, you're allowed to record. So you can turn on your telephone, it could be an audio recording, it could be a video recording. But you also want to be sensible in what you do. So you cannot take your phone and go right up to the person's face and get in his way, because then you may be charged with obstruction, right? And getting in his way from doing his job. But yes, you can record audio or video. Just make sure you do so respectfully and you're giving space. It is legal in New York. In another state, it depends on the state. Other questions? Yes?
How do you know the warrant that signed by George, the digital signature of George?
How do you know it's a signature of a judge?
Yeah.
Okay, so if in the place of judge it has the sign of a judge, anyone who's foolish enough to pretend that they signed it on behalf of judge has really crossed the lines into illegality, and they will get into serious trouble for doing so. You cannot put your name as a judge. That's very, very highly, you know, problematic, and they will get into a lot of trouble. So let's say, for example, that that's the case, and you have a copy of it, and then your attorney looks at it, and they investigate, and they say, oh my God, there's no such a judge. They themselves can then be thrown in jail.
My question to that question is, does the judge stamp on it with the name, with the signature on the bottom, or has to be just one?
No, it's usually just a signature. There can be a stamp, but the point is that, so there's two things you want to keep in mind. Number one, if it's fraudulent, meaning it was a lie, the entire thing was a lie, then anything that they saw or took, they can't use against you anyway, generally speaking. Okay? So let's say they found something. Even if they found something terrible in your home, because they did it illegally, they can't use it. That's the first thing. So you're protected in that sense as well. But if we find out that somebody was foolish enough to do such a thing, then they themselves have to face the law. Because that in and of itself is a very problematic. Any other questions? Federal law that will put you in prison for like 7 years. officer over anything. Again, never lie to can they lie to you?
Yes.
And they do all the time. It's part of their job to investigate. That's how they get information. Okay? Even if you, and this is part of why I say don't speak to them and have conversations even if you have nothing to hide. Because if you've inadvertently forgotten something or you misrepresented something completely innocently and they can't find anything else about you, they now have you at least for supposedly lying to them. So don't subject yourself to that kind of issue. Any other questions?
Can simply people say refuse to answer a question for somebody else? Unfortunately, there are some Muslims, even they pray, even they bragging about in front of me, it was years ago. Hey, call me. I said, I'm busy now. Call me tomorrow. I'll answer the questions.
Yeah, so
they refuse.
Yeah, you can refuse, whether they're asking you about yourself or someone else. Is that what you're asking?
Yeah,
of course you can refuse. Just like you don't have to answer for yourself, you don't have to answer for anyone else.
But his brother was so proud. They called him. And he was happy to make a call for the mom.
I don't know what was in his mind, to be honest with you. I think that's, you know, in my legal opinion, that's very foolish. And like I said, once they know that they can speak to you, whether it's about yourself or about others, they will continue to come to you. What we call fishing expeditions. That means they're just looking for information, right? And they'll start asking, did you go to the masjid? Who's the imam? What do they talk about during Jum'ah? We have imams in our community that don't give a lecture or khutbah without taping themselves. We have lawsuits in place because the NYPD, there's like a legal request for information, and generally they're supposed to give you that information, but they're using something called the Glomar response, which only the CIA uses, which basically says, I'm not going to use the normal exceptions allowed under the law. You know, sometimes when you ask law enforcement for documents, they may redact portions, meaning they take a marker and they cross things out, whatever, if it's sensitive or whatnot. But at least a court can see it. Now the NYPD is trying to say, we neither confirm nor deny the existence that those documents even exist. Do you know what that does? You know what they're trying to do? They're trying to say, we're not even going to let the judge know under his discretion, in his privacy, whether or not we're doing this, because we're not going to confirm or deny that such a thing exists in the first place. What does that mean? That means no accountability. That means you can't even challenge them. Because what evidence will you have? This is one of the things that's being litigated right now. Again, I'm sorry, there's a lot to, you know, that I can't speak about. We're gonna keep it at here because it is getting late. I appreciate the time that you've given me. Jazakumullah khairan. I'll hang out for a few minutes if you need to speak to me, or if you want to talk to me in private, you have our cards. Put my cards there too. Jazakumullah khairan. And please, again, do not hesitate to reach out to us. Like I said, there are 35 offices, but there's only one New York office. We're in Astoria. Give us a call anytime you need
us.
Can
I ask the last question?
Yes, Michael.
Are you guys being watched, harassed by CARE particularly?
So we know we're being watched, and we know we're enemies. Probably, I mean, let's put it this way. I don't know if you guys know that the executive director of the national office, his name is Nihad Awad.
No, Ziyad, the brother too.
Yes, brother Ziyad. So he's in New York and he's currently the board president. The point is that he was declared an enemy by ISIS, who actually put him on the front of their magazine. Why? Because they don't like what he's doing for the Muslims here. And the government is watching him here. So he can't do good here and he But if we're a strong organization of attorneys across the country who are taking in information and can say, look, you're profiling us and that is unconstitutional, then we can say it on your behalf. And that is something that we are not afraid to do. And alhamdulillah, I'll tell you this, that the overwhelming majority of the time when people call us and tell us we've had an agent come to our door and then we contact the agent, the overwhelming majority of the time, the agent never bothers them again. They don't even follow up with us. Why? Because now they know that there's an organization who's going to fight and say, why are you here? Is there a legitimate reason or are you just looking for information? Right? And if there is a legitimate reason, you're being investigated, then definitely want an attorney.